Okay, well, thank you very much for coming today. Well, maybe you didn't come for me, maybe you came for the meeting. But it was great to watch democracy in action here. And my name is Anthony Amore, and I'm the Director of Security at the Gardner, as Don introduced me. I'm also the Chief Investigator at the museum, looking for the 13 stolen items that you probably all heard about by now. They were stolen 25 years ago. And I'd like to emphasize that I'm the Chief Investigator at the Gardner because I'm also the only investigator at the Gardner, and I like is my chance to make myself feel good about myself. So what I'd like to do is talk to you a little bit about art theft tonight leading up to the Gardner, and just give you a little bit of history as to how I came to write this book, and it'll illustrate art theft in general. So bear with me. In 2005, I was working for the government, and I had worked in Homeland Security positions, unpopular agencies that are now considered Homeland Security, so unpopular agencies like Immigration Service. Then I was a special agent with the FAA, and then after 9/11, I was an assistant director with Homeland Security, rebuilding security at Logan Airport. And one Sunday afternoon, I wasn't looking for a new job, but I was leafing through the Boston Globe. And I was looking, I was just happened to be in the job classified section. Remember when there used to be jobs in the newspaper? And I saw an opening for security director at the Isabella Stewart Gardner Museum. And it was one of those small ads, like two or three lines. And it was between like secretary and service desk at Pep Boys, like that sort of thing. And I read it and I said, this is the place that had that enormous theft. And this is how they're advertising for a new security director? So I applied because I wanted to see what this was all about. So when I went to the interview, now first of all, I should ask, how many of you have not been to the Gardner Museum? Just one? I should have brought free passes for you. I guarantee you, you're going to want to go. Okay. But the rest of you, thank you, and I hope you come back often. But you all remember the first time you walked in and you saw that courtyard. Right, because it's one of those moments in your life you can't believe this thing is in the middle of the Fenway, and it's breathtaking. And that's how I felt when that's where my interview was, right at the courtyard. And I had worked in airport settings for most of my career. In fact, the week before I had my interview, when I was with Homeland Security, we had this threat information about terrorists trying to use these things called man pads, their shoulder-fired rockets, at aircraft near airports. So we were out in South Boston in these dumps looking for places that people might hide to do it at Logan. And then now here I am all of a sudden at the Isabella Stewart Gardner Museum looking at this courtyard, and I said, I could literally come here every day and look at this. I'll take the job. There was some negotiating in there. I'm not going to be dishonest. But I took the job. And I was in a unique position because I understood how to secure a facility, but I also had done investigations in my career, so it was a good match because the Gardner is in the unfortunate and unique situation where they needed someone who could do security for a facility and investigate a theft as well. So I took the job, and of course, during the interview, I said how confident I was to find these stolen paintings, et cetera. But all I knew about art theft was what the general public knows. And what does the general public know? They know what they've seen in the movies and on television. And there's a good reason for that. Even though we're in Bedford, how many people here tonight have had a multi-million dollar painting stolen from their home? Right. I've yet to see someone who has. So how would you know? How would you know who takes them and what becomes of them? All you know is what you see in the movies, like me. So you go by what you see in the Thomas Crown Affair or what have you. So I said, I have to take a bit more academic approach than just watching the greatest movies that I could find. And I'm very data-oriented, so I decided to take a similar approach to what we use in the government for terrorism, which was to try to do this link analysis. And that essentially means getting all the data you can and then skimming it down. I often liken it to having looking for 13 needles in a haystack. So you find the haystack, then you make the haystack as small as you can and get to the needles. So I was ambitious, and I created this monstrous database in which I would record all the information I could find about art heists. And it was, it had every field you could imagine, from the day of the week the theft happened, what time of day, what type of facility, were the thieves armed, did they hurt the guards, how many guards were there, was there a reward, what happened to the art, how long did it take for it to be recovered, where was it found, everything you can imagine, and then some. So I said, I'm going to look at every art heist in the last 100 years. So I stopped working, and within a few hours on my first day of doing this, I realized it was a mistake. It was a mistaken approach. Because the first thing I learned about art theft that day was that it is an enormous worldwide problem. I did not realize that after guns and drugs, nothing is trafficked more than art and antiquities. It's a $6 to $8 billion per year illicit industry, believe it or not. So that was too big for me to be effective right away. And I sat back, I thought, at the Gardner we lost 3 Rembrandts in a unique fashion, let me focus on Rembrandt. And what I found was in the last 100 years there were 81 Rembrandt thefts. So I cataloged them, and it took me a couple of years to get all the data I needed on it, a few years actually, about three or four. And as I was putting these stories aside and collecting this info, I said to myself, these would make an interesting book someday, these different stories, because they really illustrate how this happens. And that's how I came to write this book. But not just, it didn't just benefit me in the sense of writing a book, it helped me with the investigation because I learned some really important things. Number one, the way art theft happens in real life is nothing at all like you see in the movies. There is no similarity between the two, nothing. And it's actually more interesting in real life. Number two, the types of guys who steal art are not these brilliant cat burglars like you've seen in films either. They're common criminals. And number three, and I love giving this talk in my home state here because I like to be able to tell the audience that I found that the 3 most significant art heists in history all happened here in the Commonwealth of Massachusetts. So you could sit up proud in your chairs and add that to the list of mayhem that we've suffered here in Massachusetts. So I think it takes a second for it to advance. Oh, there it is, okay. This is what most people think of when they think of art theft, right? Most of you have seen some of these films and TV shows. Many of you in this room probably remember the show It Takes a Thief, right? With Robert Wagner. And top right-hand corner, of course, is Pierce Brosnan as Thomas Crown. And in the center, how many of you have seen the movie Entrapment with Sean Connery and Catherine Zeta-Jones? A few of you, right? So this is an important scene from the movie, and it illustrates the folly of how Hollywood depicts art crime. In this scene, Catherine Zeta-Jones is being trained to act like an art thief. So Sean Connery blindfolds her, and she makes her way through these red laser beams, moving really adeptly through the what would you call it, a matrix of laser beams. Well, I've looked at, to date now, I've studied 1,300 different art heists. And not one of them did I find that the thief wore a blindfold. So that's not true. But the other thing to remember, and this is something you see in a lot of shows, these red laser beams don't exist. Nobody uses those, right? So that's, I don't know why, that's just something for movies. But think about it intuitively, right? We have motion sensors, but they're invisible. And they cover a whole arc. Like if I was putting them in a block to cover this room, I'd put them in opposite corners, set the arc at the right angle to cover the whole room. Why would we put visible laser beams that someone could say, take one step to the left, hop 2 feet over to the right, step around them? It doesn't work that way. But this is the way it's depicted in movies. Now, I want to start by pointing out Robert Wagner in It Takes a Thief. Does anybody here remember his character's name in that show? Excellent. I love it when people remember that. Al Mundy. His name is Al Mundy. Now, this is what real art thieves look like. These are Massachusetts guys. Not a Pierce Brosnan in the bunch, you can see. Now, I'm going to start with the guy in the top left-hand corner. His name is Florian Mundy. And in the early 1970s, Florian was a common crook, a thief. Loved to steal anything that wasn't bolted down, okay? If he was with me when I just went over to pay homage to the flag at the library, the flag would be gone. He would steal that camera, probably the clock, anything. And he was such a prolific thief, he was out in Worcester, that area, that people started calling him Al. Al Monday, like the thief on the TV show. And to this day, he goes by Al. I know him really well. He's Al Monday. Nobody calls him Florian. And like I said, he would steal, and that was his job. But he's kind of, he's a smarter guy than most criminals. Now, when I say he's smarter than most criminals, most of the time, like in novels or again on TV, people depict them as being master criminals, these brilliant crooks. When I say smart, I didn't say he was smarter than you guys, I said he's smarter than the average criminal. So he's not a super genius, but he's not a dummy, okay? And he was actually taking a course at Assumption College in the early 1970s, and he was unhappy with his income as a thief. Because when you would steal something, the going rate, and still true today, is about 10%. So if you steal something, whatever the value is, if you can find someone to sell it to, a fence, you're going to get about 10% of its value. So if you steal a car worth $2,000 in 1971, maybe you're going to get $200 for it. And it takes a lot of work to earn a living that way. And as he told me, he was at Assumption College. He's total flair for exaggeration. He said he walked out of the college one day and he saw across the street the Worcester Art Museum. Now, it's not across the street, so he embellished a little, but he had learned a lot about art and antiques because his mother was interested in that sort of thing, and she taught him from when he was a young man about art and antiques and the value of them. So he decided, if I can get 10% for a stolen item, why am I stealing these bits and pieces here and there? I should steal millions of dollars worth of art. So if I steal $20 million worth of art and I can fence it for 10%, now I got $2 million. That's a lot today, never mind in 1972. So it sounds like a good plan. So he starts thinking about it and he goes to the museum and he's walking around, he visits it often, and as he's walking around, he's looking for what paintings he thinks would be most valuable. Now, mind you, he didn't go in there looking for some specific piece that some master criminal pointed out. He wanted the obscure little Degas sketch over in the corner, because that's not how it happens in real life. That's the movies. In real life, the thieves are looking for the most valuable pieces. And as an example, Al's favorite artist is Renoir, and they have Renoir at the Worcester Art Museum. But he didn't steal Renoir. He looked to steal the Rembrandt, two paintings by Gauguin, and a Picasso, because he thought that's where he could get the most money. And that's how thieves figure it out. They're looking for value, okay? So he walks around a number of times. He takes mental measurements of the pieces. He checks how they're secured to the wall. He does a survey of the guards and the security system. And then, as to show he's a smarter guy than most, he didn't plan to steal it himself. He was going to get two schnooks to steal it for him, two underlings. Two very young guys, around 20, 21 years old. And he showed them the plan. He told them he'd give them a cut. These are just the same old guys he would use to rob, you know, steal a car or to do a home invasion, that sort of thing. Everyday common criminals who do it for a living. So he takes them to the museum and he walks through it a number of times. How many of you have been to the Worcester Art Museum? Wow, that's a really good showing. This must be an art-loving town. Because most of the, even when I'm in Worcester, I don't see that many hands go up. So you know the museum then. Let me show you. It's 1972. And Al's plan is to rob the museum in broad daylight. Now that sounds counterintuitive. Most people picture these overnight heists. But in fact, in all of these art thefts I've looked at, more than half of them happen in the daytime when the place is open. And there's a reason for that, right? If you go to rob a place in the middle of the night, you need to penetrate what's essentially a fortress at that point, right? Everything's locked up, all the alarms are on. If you're suspicious near the building, the cops might come, security's looking at you. But if you do it, a museum especially, if you do it when it's open, nobody thinks anything when you walk right up to these incredibly valuable pieces. So that's the plan. And he coaches these two young guys on how to do it. Walks them by the art, shows it to them a number of times, and points out the guards to them. And these guys seem to have it down. Al even went to his sister-in-law and told her he needed her to make these velvet bags to put the art in, to sew these bags. She was a seamstress. And she said, sure, no problem. Just like many of you would, right? If your brother-in-law said, I need these bags for some stolen paintings, no problem, I'll make them for you. So she said yes. That's the kind of family it was. Yeah. And on the appointed day, it was May of 72, Al has the two guys who are going to rob the museum come to his home, and they show up. He goes over the plan again, because these are not smart guys. And what he does is give them both gives both of them a blue windbreaker to wear. And he did this because he wanted them to sort of look like they worked together in the museum. Like maybe it looked like a uniform, right? Because they were just going to walk in and take these paintings off the wall with people there. Yeah. Now again, that sounds strange, right? But how many of you now have been to a museum when art is being moved? How many of you have seen paintings being taken from the wall? You don't see that. Some people might. But it's very rare, because we only do it when we're closed, right? So you would think the public would intervene if two guys do this, but they don't in real life. Nobody wants to seem like, nobody wants to say anything, especially two guys dressed alike. Now, he gave them both ski masks. Now, those are not museum employee looking things, but they kept them rolled up, and it was May, and as you know, well, was it 90 degrees today, but sometimes there was a frost alert the other night. So if you see a guy walking with a winter hat on in May, maybe you won't think of anything in Massachusetts. So he gives them these things, and it's time to go. He needs a car. He sends another guy, his picture was up a second ago, he was in the center, David Aquafresca, and he says, I need you to steal a car. And he tells him to steal a station wagon, because in 1972, as you remember, they're huge, right? There's no such thing as a small station wagon in 1972. And he needs a big way back, because Gauguin's Brooding Woman is a large painting. It's not going to fit in the back of a car easily. And the guy, David, goes to steal a car, and he steals that car the way you guys drink water. Does it every day, piece of cake, no problem, boss. He steals this big station wagon. He brings it to Al's house, and they're ready to go. Al tells the guys, have at it. It's around noontime. And they don't go anywhere. They just look at him. And he says, well, what are you waiting for? And they said, where's our gun? And he said, there's no gun in this plan. And they said, well, we're not doing this without a gun. We want a gun. And he said, listen, we've been through this. Gun's not a part of the plan. The guards are all elderly gentlemen, slight of build. Nobody's armed in the museum. You don't need a gun. You're young, tough guys. And they said, well, we're not doing it without a gun. So Al does what any one of us would do. He went into his bedroom to his dresser and got a stolen revolver he had, and he gave it to him and said, now, be on your way. So now they're happy. They walk outside the house, they look inside, and there's no bullets. So they come back in the house, the same type of argument ensues, and Al acquiesces. But I remember him telling me this, he took one bullet, he gave him one bullet, and he handed it out to him, they reached for it, he pulled it back, and he said, don't shoot anyone. Now, like Al said to me, he was worried about them putting blood on his paintings. Not physically, not literally, but figuratively, because you don't want that type of heat on you from the police shooting someone over these paintings. No problem, we're not here to shoot anyone, but we needed our gun. Okay, so they go to the museum, and as I tell you how they pull this off, try to draw parallels between art heist films you've seen. They walk into the Worcester Art Museum, and you probably recognize this. This is Renaissance Court. And Worcester Art Museum has one of the world's greatest collections of Antioch mosaics. And this is one of them, a real large one. And in 1972, it didn't have a rail around it. That's a modern picture. Back then, people had the good sense not to walk on a mosaic. Nowadays, you need a rail. So they walk in to the right, to your right. And they come in, and they want to be nondescript because they're going to go steal four paintings. And I don't know if many of you have seen The Godfather. If you remember when Michael Corleone is getting his marching orders from Clemenza about shooting Lieutenant McCloskey, Captain McCloskey, the restaurant. And he tells him, don't run away, and don't walk away, but don't run either. He says, don't look anybody in the eye, but don't look away either. In other words, just blend. So that's what these guys were supposed to do. They walk in, and as they're walking in, they see these two young high school seniors, females, who are particularly attractive. And these guys are about 20, so what do? They go over to the girls and they say, you should sit over here, something big's gonna happen. So they miss the whole lesson about blending in, okay? Ski masks are up, Right, so now the girls have seen them. I've met one of these girls too. It's just amazing to meet these people. So they walk up the stairs to the second floor and they go right to the paintings they're supposed to steal, and it goes off without a hitch. They take the four paintings off the walls. Nobody says a word to them. They've taken Rembrandt, two Gauguin, and a Picasso, and they're home free. They walk down the stairs with them, and as they're walking to leave, they walk onto the mosaic. They step to the center of the mosaic, and there's a guard standing right here, and he sees them on the mosaic, and he yells for them to stop, and they figure he's got us. And he says, "You two, get off the mosaic." So now they figure they're home free. They walk a little further, but he had slowed them down enough to see that they were carrying something, and he stops them again. So now they really realize that they're not going to make it. So what do? They take the gun and they shoot him. Shoot the guard. Shoot him in the hip. Hip area. They didn't hit the bone, but he's in serious condition. He hits the floor. Now, all of you are almost all of you are museum goers. And have you been to Worcester? We need another motion. A motion. Imagine being in a museum, and it's cement and marble, right, in this great hall, and imagine a gunshot, right? Mayhem. I can't imagine hearing that. It must be so scary to hear this noise. Out in a field, it's loud. So, and then you see a guard hit the floor, and he's bleeding profusely. Everybody's crowding around him, which is ideal for the thieves. They just walk out, and he's on the floor. Luckily for the guard, when he got shot, he had been giving directions in the museum to a visitor who was a nurse, and she saved his life. So he lived. But the two guys walk out to their getaway car, to the station wagon. The driver gets behind the wheel, and the other guy takes the three smaller paintings and puts them in the back seat. And you remember why I told you they stole a station wagon? He takes the big painting, the Gauguin, and he gets in the car and puts it on the roof, like this, on top of the roof. Just like George Clooney would do in Ocean's 12, right? So the driver hit, this is a true story, by the way. So the driver hits the gas, and the car jerks, and the painting falls off. So what does he do? He picks it up and puts it back on the roof. But this time, they make off with it. And for all their bumbling and silly, goofy behavior, they have pulled off one of the biggest art heists in world history. They're gone. Everybody's tending to the guard. They take the paintings to Al Mundy. He tells me he hit him in his drop ceiling, which is physically impossible, but he hit him in the house. And they get rid of the getaway car, and what do? They go to their favorite bar, right? And that's what these guys do. And even though this is a major heist and they're very proud of themselves, it's just another job. They're going to steal something again later in the week. So they go into this big bar, I forget the name of it right now, and they go in, and it's 2:30 in the afternoon, and it's packed wall to wall because it's Worcester. So what are you going to do? So they go in, and they're going to have a couple of drinks to celebrate their heist, and they're talking about what they pulled off, and all of a sudden, the place comes to a hush, because the televisions in the bar have breaking news on them. And now, most of you in this room remember there was a day when television said breaking news, and it literally meant there was breaking news. It didn't mean, like, every channel you put on now says breaking news continuously, right? But I remember once upon a time that would give you shivers, like, oh my God, something big happened. Like, you almost hold your breath, what's it gonna be? And the guys in the bar are watching it, and it's a local anchorman, so now they're really paying attention. And he says, breaking news out of Worcester, so now they're all really attentive. And he says, there's been a theft at the Worcester Art Museum. A guard has been shot and rushed to the hospital. He's in critical condition. Four paintings have been stolen, a multi-million dollar heist, including a Rembrandt. FBI and state police are on scene. The thieves are armed and dangerous and still at large. Details at 6. And the whole place is, you know, chattering like crazy. They're all figuring, who was this? Who must this have been? Can you believe this happened? There's a real buzz, and these two guys, everyone knows them there. So what do you think they do, being master crooks? They say, hey, that was us. Is there anybody here tonight who is a law enforcement officer or a one-time investigator? or anything? Well, all right, I've been doing this for 25 years. I'm going to tell you a secret. That's a very good lead. When the thieves announce it to their friends in community, you should follow up on that lead. So the police did, and they arrested these guys right away. So these guys are caught, but they're not giving up Al Mundy just yet. And Al Mundy has the paintings, and he's trying to sell them like he thought he could. He's reaching out to all his contacts because he's such a well-known crook. So he has a lot of fences in the community, and he knows a lot of organized crime contacts, so he's trying hard to get rid of these things. This is the Rembrandt painting that was stolen. This is Rembrandt's St. Bartholomew. Has anybody seen the movie American Hustle? Bradley Cooper and Christian Bale. There's a scene where those two are in the Worcester Art Museum looking at this painting, and Christian Bale's character says, "This is a fake. I can assure you it's not a fake." And those of you who've been to Worcester and seen this, you understand that this is an amazing painting. Rembrandt painted St. Bartholomew three times in his career, and every one of them he's in the same sort of composition, but he looks different in each. And this has the earmarks of a true Rembrandt, in that you can really see the glow coming from the person. It's one of these things you can't describe, but you know it when you see it, a great Rembrandt, the light is coming from him. Vermeer, as you might know, is the master of light on the subject, which is mind-boggling as well, and always makes me shake my head when I go into a shopping mall and I see Thomas Kincaid, the master of light, and I think of Vermeer rolling over in his grave every time one of those opens. But if you haven't seen this, it's worth the trip all the way to Worcester. It's amazing. Now, in this painting, this is really a pretty good image, and some of you might be able to see right here, St. Bartholomew is holding a flaying knife. And the great masters would paint martyred saints either holding or standing by some emblem of their martyrdom. St. Bartholomew was skinned alive at the stake. And that resonates with me because when I was a kid, I went to elementary school at a Catholic school in Providence called St. Bartholomew's. And I remember being in the first grade, Sister Martina telling us that our patron saint was skinned alive. And when you're six, that sticks with you for a long time. So 42 years later, I'm still bringing up the same story about Sister Martina. But this painting really gets me, but it is amazing. And the other thing I would tell you, I could tell, really, you guys are an unusually committed museum-going crowd, because most of the time you get a smattering of people who've been to Worcester, maybe 80% have been to the Gardner. But this painting reminds me, this is a really nice print. This photo was taken for me, high resolution, by the people at Worcester, and it's really nice, but it's night and day from seeing it in person. So if you have a favorite painting that you haven't seen and you have the means, you really should make it a point to see it because it's a whole different experience. So this is the painting that's stolen. This is the Rembrandt that's stolen. And Al Mundy says it's at his home. And he tells me that the police come to his house because they know these two guys usually work for Al, the two guys they arrested. So a Worcester cop and the FBI come to his home, and he told me the painting's right above his head when he was standing at the door. It's impossible, but that's Al. He has to lay it on. He told me there were 200 investigators working on this case, too. I'm going to show you a picture of him later. So they tell him, "We're on to you Monday," et cetera, et cetera. But the cops have to dot I's and cross T's. You know, they have to have a probable cause. I know there's an attorney in the audience. You know, they have to do the right thing. You know, even in the 1970s, most of them did the right thing. So they were doing their investigation, and they leave. So Al says to himself, "Not only do I have to sell these things, in the short term, I got to move them. I can't keep them here because they're going to be back. Next time, they might be back with a warrant." So he has to find a place to hide them. And this is where he brings them. He brings them to the Pachillo Pig Farm in Johnston, Rhode Island. So when you think about paintings being hidden, you think of all these really unique places they could be hidden. But Al chose the greatest example probably in art history of the sacred and the profane. He took these four masterworks to Johnston and hid them in a hayloft at a pig farm. And this pig farm is unique also because it is the most polluted place in the United States of America at the time. It was the first EPA Superfund site. those barrels you see, there's hundreds of acres of these barrels, and they're all filled with hazardous waste. And that's where the painting is. Meanwhile, he's still trying to sell them. But what he's finding is that there are no buyers. Why are there no buyers? Well, because this story is front page news, not just in Worcester and in Massachusetts, but across the United States. And I've seen the newspapers from abroad, and it was on the front page of papers internationally. This was a major heist. Al's challenge was now to find someone who could give him 10 cents on the dollar for millions of dollars worth of paintings that are so hot you can only wind up in jail. So even if you buy them, you can never show anybody. So there's no buyers for them. Now, not only did the police know these were Al's guys that were arrested, the bad guys knew as well. And while this is going on, it's on the front page of the paper, there's two particularly violent criminals who are awaiting sentencing on a probation violation. They were on probation for a home invasion they did, and while on probation did another home invasion, armed. And they're still out, because it's Massachusetts in 1972, so you wouldn't want to lock anybody up. These guys are running around, and they see this is Monday's gang. They go and do what the cops can't do, because they want to curry some favor with the judge. They go to Monday's house. When he answers, they put the gun in his ribs, and they say, take us to the paintings. He drives them to Johnston. They get the paintings, and they return them to the judge. And these two guys get a very small sentence reduction. But the paintings come back. Here's the picture of those 200 investigators, by the way. It was two FBI agents and two Worcester cops. But they got them back. And what you see in the middle is the brooding woman by Gauguin, the one that fell off the, that was on the roof of the car. Over here to the left is the Picasso, and the bottom is the other Gauguin. And it's weird how it's moving. And in the background, it's Rembrandt. And you can see the Rembrandt doesn't have its frame, because when Al was transporting him, in the way only a crook could do, he felt that particular frame was weighing him down, so he took it off and threw it in the Blackstone River. So that frame is gone, but they got the paintings back. And this is the guard. When the painting came back to the museum shortly after the theft, the guard had recovered well enough to come to the ceremony when the painting was put back on the wall, Phil Evans. And everyone lived happily ever after in this crime. But the reason I tell you the story is for a few reasons, actually. Number one, it's the first time in history that a piece of art was stolen at gunpoint. It's the first armed robbery of paintings in history here in your home state of Massachusetts. The other reason I like to tell you about it, though, is because it's the first really good example that you should remember about thieves stealing art, thinking they can sell it, but then finding right away it's too highly recognizable and too valuable to fence. And that's the theme throughout history. When thieves steal this stuff, they can't find buyers for it. Again, I'm talking about highly recognizable, valuable art. Everyone thinks this stuff is stolen and winds up on the wall of the Sultan of Brunei, or Dr. Evil somewhere, Dr. No. And the reason Dr. No comes up, there's actually, in my line of work, there's like six people like me, but we call it the Dr. No theory. And it stems from the movie. Have you all seen Dr. No, the first Bond film? When that movie was, when the book was written by Ian Fleming, this doesn't happen, but they wrote it into the screenplay. So while the movie's being made, this painting by Goya, the Duke of Wellington, is stolen from the National Gallery in Britain. And everybody's assuming it's some rich, master, genius criminal, right? Nobody knows where it is. So into the film, they put this scene when Bond is being led to dinner with Dr. No, he walks by the painting in his underground lair. And he looks at it as if to say, oh, there it is. You know, that's what happened to it. The true story is an old age pensioner in Britain who was unhappy with the TV tax, and his son climbed in a bathroom window at the National Gallery and stole the painting. And they had it in their flat in London. This is how these things really happen. So now it's 3 years later, and there's another major art heist. And this one happens in Boston. Now, you've all been to the MFA? You have? That actually makes me feel sad, because if you had just walked out those doors and crossed the street, right about here, you would have went to the Gardner. And as all the rest of you know, the Gardner has a far superior collection in terms of quality than the MFA. Right? Thank you. We have the A-list stuff. They have a lot of B-list stuff. Okay. A lot of it, yeah. So, 1975, another theft happens, and I show you this overhead view of the MFA because this is an important part of the theft. This is the getaway route. The thieves pull up to this entrance here where those two big baby heads are. That's the Fenway, and then that part of the Fenway is one way. So if you do an afternoon theft, just like the Worcester theft, and there's no Red Sox game, you're not going to hit traffic, and that's going to take you to Storrow Drive or to 93. So in other words, you can go north, south, east, or west, and if you have 45-second lead on the police, they're not going to catch you. You're gone. So the thieves pull up in the afternoon to that circular drive in front of the stairs in a small red car, and the car has four guys in it. Now, I know who committed this theft. They were never arrested or prosecuted. The statute of limitations has expired. But because the statute has expired, anybody can say they did it. They can't get in trouble. So I've met far more than four guys who say they were involved in this heist. None of them are the two guys who actually did it. So they pull up in this small red car, and two guys get out of the car, and they're both carrying semi-automatic pistols. And they're loaded for beer. This is not one bullet, and these two guys are professional killers. They're vicious killers. No compunction, if they're sadistic, they would kill just for the fun of it. That's the sort of guys they are. And they know exactly what they're doing. They come in, they walk up the stairs, they go in like any other visitor would, they go to the second floor, and they head right for the Rembrandt. This painting here. At the time of the theft, 1975, it's May again, this painting is called Portrait of Elizabeth Van Ryn. Has anybody seen this painting before? It's owned by a private owner, and it's on loan to the MFA at the time. This thing is staggeringly beautiful, right? So it's about that size in real life, and it's on an oak oval panel. They go into the gallery, they just yank it off the wall, they come down the stairs, and they're not messing around. They run out with it, and when they get into the hall, the great hall again, they fire warning shots. And I've talked to people who were there at the time. It's incredibly frightening and startling. Everybody's screaming. And these guys run down those front stairs, and just to show that they mean business, they turn and they fire shots at the stairs in case anybody decides to chase after them. Right? This guy, I like to think that the guards back then, I think it's a kind of a better generation. And this guard here, Mr. Monkowski, ran after them with bullets being shot in his direction to the point that he caught them as they were getting in the car, and he grabbed the painting. And there's a tug of war over this panel painting. And the thief puts a gun to his head. The driver says, "Don't shoot him." And the thief just slams him in the head with the gun, and that's why he's showing his injury here. But it's really an amazing thing for someone to run after a painting that way. Has anybody here ever worked or volunteered in a museum? If you did, you would know. It sounds strange to people who don't work in that atmosphere, but once you do fall in love with paintings where you feel like, I gotta save that painting. And that's what this guy did. So he runs after it. Now here's the problem. They get away, they drive off, and they're gone in a cloud of smoke. And it's nothing like Al Mundy's guys. They're not bumbling. They don't go say, hey, we did it. They just disappear. And nobody has the slightest idea who stole this painting. It's just gone. It's gone. There's no ransom demands. There's no hot leads on it. There's no information about it all. It's just missing. And it's not like the Gardner. And this is no insult to the MFA, but at any other museum, if a painting's stolen, especially one on loan, and you have that blank spot on the wall, you get something out of storage and you put it there. It's not like Mrs. Gardner's place where it has to stay as was. So now it's gone and investigators have no leads. And remember, it's 1975. Some of you might have heard of this guy. His name's Miles Connor. And he's a legendary crook in Massachusetts history. Maybe the most prolific criminal in state history. I mean, I know Whitey Bulger killed 19 people and all the rest, but if you ran a guy's criminal history and you look at it for sheer variety and mania, his is probably the most awe-inspiring one, not in a good way. He's done everything. He's stolen everything. He's dealt drugs, stolen drugs. He's one of the few people in history, in the world, who you can say has stolen art more than once. There's this idea of a professional art thief, in terms of masterpieces, is folly, because guys steal the art, they realize there's no money to be made from it, and they never steal it again. But this guy can't help himself. In 1973, Miles and some of his friends went up to Monmouth, Maine, and they went to the Woolworth Estate. Remember the Woolworth's shopping, the Five and Dime or whatever it was? They go into the estate and they steal everything they can get their hands on. They steal a bunch of silver, they steal a grandfather clock, furniture, all kinds of antiques. And as they're making their way out, Miles sees four masterpieces by the Wyatts that he can't help himself, and he takes them. And these things are worth millions of dollars, and they're very recognizable, but he takes them anyway, thinking, who knows, maybe I can sell them. If I can't, so what? And he spends years trying to sell them, and he can't find a buyer. Why? Because, as I said before, they're too well-known, they're too highly recognizable, and they're too valuable. There's no one that wants to give you that much money for something they can't show anybody. But he keeps trying, and the years pass, and 73, 74, 75, 76 comes along, and he gets a bite through his massive criminal network. Been in every jail you can name. And he finds out there's a guy named Bernie who's out there looking for some hot art. Now, I always mention that I love giving this talk in Massachusetts, because when I say hot art, nobody laughs at the way you say it. But that's what he's looking for. And Miles is an adventurous sort, and he says, I'll meet with Bernie. And he sets the appointment 6 a.m. on a Sunday morning in a big parking lot for a grocery store on the Cape. And he goes there, he's expecting Bernie's not going to show, and when he gets there, Bernie's there already. And he pulls up to him, he talks to him, he feels him out a bit here, and he gets a sense of Bernie, and he decides he's going to take the risk, and he opens the trunk and shows Bernie these four paintings. And Bernie is floored. He's like, steps back a bit, he can't believe what he's seeing. He tells him, these are what I'm looking for. This is it. This is exactly the sort of thing I want. And they start talking price right away, because Bernie wants these paintings. And they agree on a price, and Bernie's happy with it. He reaches in his wallet, and he just hands Miles his FBI badge and arrests him, because there are no buyers for this sort of art. So now Miles is under arrest. And again, it's Massachusetts, it's 1976. He's out on bail for a state crime, because God forbid you be locked up in Massachusetts. So he's in big trouble now. They had him red-handed on the state charge, and now they got him dead to rights on the federal charge. And all the prosecutors hate this guy, and they want him to get consecutive sentencing. They want him to do his state time and go right to federal time and just get him off the streets for as long as possible. And Miles knows he's going away. He knows that's part of his life, but he wants concurrent sentencing so that he can do it all in one fell swoop and get back out and make people's lives miserable again. So he has to pull some strings, and he turns to his family, because his father is a sergeant in the Milton Police, and he has brothers. One's a state trooper, and the other is a priest. So of course, in Massachusetts, how can you beat a state trooper and a priest? Well, a politician would help. So they get him a meeting with the prosecutor's office in Norfolk County. And he goes to the meeting and he pleads his case. And he, I know I'm going away, but I want concurrent sentences. Please help me, et cetera, et cetera. Prosecutors tell him, Miles, there's nothing we can do for you. They get you dead to rights. They want you really badly. You're going away for these consecutive sentences. I'm sorry, we can't help you. So Miles is dejected, turns to leave. Just before he goes out the door, the guy from Norfolk County says, you know, this is an art-related crime. I don't know if you can find a Rembrandt that's been stolen. Maybe we can help you. I don't know what to tell you. So Miles shuts the door dejectedly, and he goes out into the hallway, and a light bulb goes off over his head. And he says, a stolen Rembrandt? I have one. It was his cohorts who stole this painting in the year before, in 1975. Now, one of my favorite parts of the story is that it took him a second to remember that. Now, how many of you would forget the fact that you had Now, this is an important Rembrandt, too. This is really valuable. In the mid-70s, a group called the Rembrandt Research Project formed. This is Rembrandt's top experts from around the world, because at the turn of the last century, there were something like 2,000 paintings attributed to Rembrandt in the US alone. And that's impossible, right? So this group formed to look at all of these paintings and say which are, which are not, and which might be. And when they came upon this one, they said, this is absolutely Rembrandt. In fact, it's one of the best examples of his work. This is him at the peak of his skills. The only problem is it's not Elizabeth Van Rijn. So they changed the name to this awkward title, Portrait of a Girl Wearing a Gold-Trimmed Cloak. Horrible title, but it's really valuable. They even use it to compare others to when they're trying to decide. That's how great it is. And for a long time, I was fascinated with this painting, and it took me a very long time to get a color slide of it, because it's privately owned. And when I got the slide, I was very, very excited. This is what it looks like. And then I was invited to come see it in person in North Carolina, and I turned the corner and saw it, and I'm not exaggerating, my knees buckled. This thing is staggeringly beautiful. And I'm not making this up, because before, when I used to work in Homeland Security, if someone told me that story, I'd laugh at them, I wouldn't believe it, but it's true. These things, you have to see them in person. So Miles needs to get the painting to turn it in to get his break. So again, you think, all right, he's a major famous crook. Where would this be hidden? You would think, is it in a safe deposit box? Or is it in a Swiss vault somewhere, a Swiss bank vault? Or is it on the back of a bookcase? You pull the handle and the bookcase turns and it's there or something? Close. He calls his friend Al, who lives in Quincy. He says, Al, I need that Rembrandt painting. And Al says, oh, no problem, I'll go get it. So Al drives to the north end of Boston, Hanover Street, goes upstairs to the second floor where his mother lives, says hi to his mother, goes in her bedroom and takes it out from under her bed where it was sitting for almost 3 years. Right, so that gives you an idea of the challenge of finding paintings. It's one thing to know who took them, but when you think it could be at the guy's friend's mother's apartment, you can see it's a challenge. So that's an important theft, though, because the reason I tell you this story is not just because it happened in Massachusetts, but it is the first time in a real tangible way and an impactful way that a piece of art, a stolen piece of art, was used to negotiate with prosecutors to get a break on sentencing. And today, that is one of the major reasons people steal art. They steal it as a get-out-of-jail-free card. Gangs, these disorganized crime gangs, know they're going to get arrested for something else. They steal paintings and hold them to use later. Just like in Monopoly, get out of jail free. So these things don't all happen in Massachusetts. In 1962, this painting, Portrait of Jacob de Gein III, was stolen at the Dulwich Picture Gallery in Britain. Has anybody been there? Dulwich? Beautiful little museum with incredibly beautiful paintings in it. And 9 paintings were stolen by a guy. What he did is, in the middle of the night, he cut a hole into the employee entrance on the door. And he crawled through. They called him the rubber bone thief because the hole was so small. And he stole paintings small enough to come back out the hole with, including Jacob de Gein. And I can understand why he did that on the way in, but I can't understand why he just didn't open the door on his way out and carry bigger paintings. But that's what he did. This is a crime scene photo from the next morning, and the guy's saying, hey, boss, I think this is how he got in. That's a reasonable assumption. The cool thing about this is, again, it's the early 60s, and the investigator didn't have all the forensic tools we have nowadays. He used his brain. And when he looked at the building, he saw the muddy footprints from the thief. And he asked the building manager, how is this place heated? And the manager said, from below. So he figured how long that mud must have been there to be as dry as it was. He's using that time frame, he set up a perimeter. And using that perimeter, he found the getaway car. And that led them to the thief, and they got the paintings back. Now, that painting was taken again in 1966. A thief walked into the museum, took it off the wall, put it in his bicycle basket, and just rode away. And the people in the museum were beside themselves, and they called the police. The police came right away. And I love this scene in my mind. It's like Abbott and Costello. The guy's riding his bike, and the police pull up next to him. And he's got the painting in the basket, and they pull him over. And they said, what are you doing? And he said, I'm just taking it home to sketch it. So they got that back too, but it's an important reminder. It's not just these common violent criminals that you have to protect against, it's nut jobs too, who come into the museum and do things. The painting was stolen again in the early 80s by a gang of thieves who thought they could sell it and make some money. And they couldn't sell it, so they gave it back. They put it in the back of a cab and told the authorities. And then it was stolen again in 1986. Now you'd think by now the museum would put it behind glass or something, but same thing happened. Thieves took it, tried to sell it, couldn't, gave it back. So as far as I know, it's still there now, but it's the most often stolen painting in the world. And we call it the Takeaway Rembrandt. That's the name now. And this theft happened in Britain as well at Chilham Castle. 19 paintings were stolen overnight in this enormous castle. This place was so large, it was Christmas time. They had 3 families and 6 dogs staying in the castle, and no one heard thieves break in by breaking windows and ransack the place and steal 19 paintings. You can see the frames all over the place. This is the owner the next morning. And the reason I tell you this is because the cops were onto the thieves right away. And the thieves panicked and they burned the Rembrandt. So of the 81 Rembrandt thefts, there was one that was destroyed. It was 1936, and it was Saskia at her toilet. And you can see, it took me forever to find this image. And once a painting is gone, it's gone. And the museum, my museum, our director, gives a great analogy of Hamlet or Beethoven's Fifth. Imagine these were just wiped from public consciousness. All you would have is what's in your memory. You can never see it or hear it again. Over time, it degrades, and none of it's accurate. And this is all we have of this painting. I have this, and I was able to find the Philadelphia Inquirer had it on the front page. That's the only images you'll find of this thing. Silver lining is it's never happened again. And that brings us to 1990, the one you've been waiting for, I'm sure, the bane of my existence. So 25 years ago, you probably all know this story by heart by now, but 25 years ago, 2 thieves approached the employee entrance at the Gardner, the Simmons College side. That door is no longer even there. And they rang the buzzer at 1:24 in the morning, and they told the guard that they were Boston police responding to a disturbance. And the guard, against all policy and protocol, buzzed them in. And once he buzzed him in, it was a fait accompli. There was nothing that was going to stop this crime from happening. And he never should have done that. I'm not giving away the farm here. It's every institution and age-old practice. If the police come to your building and you haven't called them, you call the police. The worst case scenario is they're supposed to be there. So he didn't do that, and he let them in. It's not to pile on this poor guy, but it's the greatest mistake in the history of property protection. So the thieves talked to the guards just for a couple of minutes. The second guard came down the stairs, said to him, do I know you? And the guard said, I don't think so. He said, let me see your ID. He takes his ID. And the fake cop says, there's a warrant out for your arrest. Come out from behind there, because the kid was behind the watch desk. So the guard comes out. The thief tells both the guards, assume the position, you're under arrest, and they get up against the wall. And they handcuff them, and once they have the cuffs on them, the thief says, gentlemen, this is a robbery. And then they start to duct tape them. They put duct tape all over their faces, over their handcuffs, and they tell them, just do what we say, we're not here to hurt you, just do what we tell you to do, and you'll be fine. And the thieves take the 2 guards into the basement, they separate them by about 40 yards, and they sit them down and they handcuff their cuffs to pipes in the basement. Now, I told you I've been looking at art theft for the last 10 years now. I've looked at 1,300 of these heists, and I've looked at how long thieves usually take doing them. And in the vast majority, if you look at a bell curve, the second longest one I've ever seen is about 20 minutes. That's incredibly long for an art heist. The thieves stayed in the Gardner for 81 minutes. There's never been a theft of paintings that comes anywhere close to how long they were in the Gardner. And amongst many things, one of the things it tells us is that they were very comfortable. They knew the police weren't coming. And the way they conducted themselves in the building tells you they knew the police weren't coming. Because I can tell from our motion sensors that we have that thieves didn't start stealing anything until they were there for 24 minutes. So at 1:48, we see them register on the second floor. and they start to steal paintings. This is the guard who let the thieves in that night. And I was grateful to Don for mentioning I was not the director of security in 1990. I would never allow red corduroys on the job or that haircut. But there you can see the duct tape wrapped around his head, and he's still handcuffed, and he's in the basement. And he had to stay like that until the police photographer came, because we needed to get the MO of how these guys did it. These are the three Rembrandts that were stolen, and they're probably familiar to you by now. In the top left-hand corner is a very small etching. It's about 2 inches by 2 inches. Self-portrait etching by Rembrandt. If you probably all know how etchings are made, but they're basically scratched onto a copper plate, which has ink applied to it, and then pressed onto paper through a big press. And what does that mean? It means that Rembrandt made multiples of these. And they're not all exactly the same, but they're incredibly close. So people have come to me with etchings that look exactly like mine, and you check them, and you're like, yes, this is a Rembrandt, and they're related. And you say, no, it's not ours, and I'm deflated. But you could go to a library, some libraries, they have this at the MFA. There's one of these, RISD Art Museum. So if you go to a museum and you see it, don't worry, it's not ours. If you go tonight after this to your friend's house and you see it, you should probably call me, because it's probably mine. In the top right-hand corner, you see Lady and Gentleman in Black, and that's the other large Rembrandt that was stolen. It's pretty big. It's about 4 feet, 4.5 feet tall. And that's one of the two that were cut from their frames. So the thieves took the frame off the wall, put it down, and cut the canvas out of its frame. And in the center is the one that's most recognizable to you, I'm sure. It's the Storm in the Sea of Galilee. And that's even larger. It's 5 feet by 4 feet. Frame, again, taken from the wall, placed on the floor, and cut out with what I think was probably a box cutter, based on how deep and how narrow the cut is. Now, this painting here, Storm in the Sea of Galilee, is the second most valuable stolen painting in the world. It's worth probably in the neighborhood of $150 million all on its own. Because the thing to remember is a lot of times people will say this is the biggest art theft in American history. And that's true, but it's a gross underestimate. This is the largest theft of anything ever anywhere that happened at the Gardner. These are the other pieces that were stolen. You can see in the bottom left-hand corner, two sketches by Degas. The top right-hand corner, you can see two more. You can see on the bottom right-hand corner a Shang Dynasty beaker that belonged in the museum. Above that, you can see a finial, a bronze Napoleonic finial. You might have seen a couple of weeks ago, I put a new reward for that piece all on its own. I offered $100,000 for it. People can contact me directly if they have any information about it. And just for that one piece, the reward is $100,000. In the top center is a painting by Govert Flink, which was bought by Mrs. Gardner as a Rembrandt. It's one of the world's great landscapes. It's called Landscape with an Obelisk. And that same Rembrandt research project identified that as not Rembrandt, but still incredibly valuable. And in the center is the concert by Johannes Vermeer. And that is the most valuable stolen painting in the world. You could say any price for it, basically. You could throw out any number, really. It's one of only 36 known Vermeers. It is probably the most valuable stolen anything in the world. And that's the white whale. That's the one that people always think of around the world when they think of a stolen painting. They think of the Vermeer. It's just amazing. And it's an interesting little Boston-related tidbit in it. Above the singer's head, you see a painting. And that is a painting that was in Vermeer's mother's home, called The Procuress by Dirk van Baberen. His mother-in-law owned it. And he painted it into this painting, and he painted it into a young woman at a virginal. And that actual painting left Vermeer's mother-in-law's home, and today is at the MFA. So that's there, and this will be at the Gardner again someday. In the top left-hand corner, I always leave this one for last. It's the Manet, Edward Manet's Chez Tortoni. And the reason I leave that for last is to give you a sense of how big a theft this was. If you forget about all the other 12 pieces that were missing, and if this was the only one stolen that night, this would still be one of the world's largest art heists that would be one of the world's most valuable stolen paintings. But because it's part of this big group, most of you, and you're Massachusetts people, might not even recognize it. You might not have ever seen it before. This is a crime scene photo from the next morning. And you can see on the floor here, the big one is the one that had the storm in the Sea of Galilee. And resting on top of it is the landscape. Am I blocking you from seeing that? Can you see that?
Yeah.
Okay. And in the center is the frame that held the Vermeer. And on the right-hand side, you can kind of see that glowing object there, that gold object. That was the little frame that held that small etching. So it tells you the thieves really had, they were very cavalier. They could have just taken that tiny frame, but they took it all apart. Now, we have four Rembrandts at the Gardner, and three were stolen. The thieves tried to take all four. They took the self-portrait from the wall, turned it around, and leaned it against a chair and forgot it. Thank God. So we still have that one. That's the self-portrait 1629 that you see in the Dutch room. This is a picture you won't see anywhere else. This is a close-up of what it looks like when a painting is cut from its frame. That's a detail of the frame that held Storm in the Sea of Galilee. So the gold part, of course, is the frame. The rosewood is the stretcher that the canvas was wrapped on. And if you see that black line coming down the left part, that's what's left of the painting. So you can see it was a very straight cut. It's not this jagged edges that people envision. But that's the Storm in the Sea of Galilee. The other thing that should jump out at you is that there are no paint chips all over the floor, which is a positive sign. That means the painting was probably not rolled, like everyone always envisions it being rolled. I can't tell you how many times people have called me and told me, I saw this big cardboard tube in my brother-in-law's basement. I think he has your paintings. And it's always the brother-in-law for some reason. It's always my brother-in-law. I don't know why. That's another shot of the Storm in the Sea of Galilee frame with the flink on top of it the next morning.
Once they're out of the frame? I mean, I realize it's more cumbersome to have the frame, but...
They're pretty rigid.
They kind of fall.
It's another reason why I don't think they were rolled. The paintings were, old paintings like this that are cared for really well are often relined. So the way a conservator would reline it is you remove it from its stretcher, they apply a thick layer of animal glue, and then another canvas. And that makes it almost like cardboard. So if you tried to roll it right away, you'd know you're wasting your time, and you'd see a lot of chips. So they're pretty stable, which is a really good sign. Now, before I just tell you that this last little anecdote, it behooves me to remind you that there's a $5 million reward for the paintings, and the reward is for information that leads me to them. You don't have to give me the paintings, you just have to call me and tell me where to get them. And you get $5 million. That's the largest reward, private reward, ever offered. I'm friends with Howie Carr. I don't know if any of you listen to Howie, but he often says that's 2.5 Whiteys. Because the Whitey reward was $2 million. This last thing I wanted to tell you, and it's the reason I'm going to tell you about this last little heist is because it applies to what happened at Boston Public Library. In 2011, there was a small Rembrandt drawing that was stolen from a small exhibition at a hotel. And it's worth about $250,000. And what the LA County Sheriff's Department did, which was really brilliant, is it wasn't too recognizable to sell, but they made it too recognizable to sell. They blasted it all over social media. The news media picked it up. And everyone in the world could see this thing. It was on the front page of everything. And then the news media in LA asked me to do TV and radio and LA Times. I said the same thing I said to the Boston Globe this last week. Was a message to the thieves, and if they ever watch Bedford Community Television, you have not stolen a picture, you've stolen a problem. It can only get you in trouble. You will never make money off of it. So give it back and hope the whole thing goes away. And this is proof positive that it can happen. The third day after the heist, the thieves must have listened because they left it at a church in Marina Del Rey and let the authorities know, and the whole thing is over. So. That's what I'm hopeful will happen with the Boston Public Library if indeed these pieces are stolen. They're still searching to see if they're in the museum. In the library, I'm sorry. The most important thing is that my next book comes out in July. This is The Art of the Con will be out in July 15th. I hope you get a chance to pick it up. I'll have Stealing Rembrandts for Sale here tonight. This one will be about fakes and forgeries and other con artist type affairs. So I hope you look for that at your favorite bookstore. But I thank you very much for coming or sticking around to hear me talk about Art Heist tonight. It's really, I have to tell you that I have two passions in the world, and one is these missing paintings. The other is the American Revolution. So just before this, I get to go over and see the flag. And the people in the library were like, all right, calm down, buddy. You know, I was like, can I see the flag? Can I take a picture? No, I'm like, okay, but you're so fortunate. I mean, so honestly, it is, when I say it's an honor for me to be in Bedford and to see this flag and talk to people involved in the history of the town, that's not a platitude. That really means a lot to me. So thank you very, very much for having me tonight. Thank you. I know it's late. I'll take questions if you like. I don't want to keep you late, but I'm happy to answer anything you might. Yes, sir.
You mentioned that the painting could have been rolled or not rolled. You know, during the war, from the beginning of the Second World War, in the Netherlands, most paintings were rolled and kept away from the Germans, including the Night Watch, which is gigantic.
Yep.
But what they did use was a carpet. They put out the carpet and rolled it.
Very true.
Not a chip paint.
That's an excellent point. And you're right, in the Second World War, they did roll a lot of them. At that time, it was less likely for those paintings to have been relined, so they wouldn't have been as stiff, and more, they would be more pliable. An interesting thing, if you've seen The Monuments Men, the character George Clooney plays is named Frank Stokes. But in reality, that character's name is George Stout. And after the war, George Stout came back home, and he became the director of the Isabella Stewart Gardner Museum. So there's a parallel with that as well. Yes, ma'am.
What is the prison sentence? Suppose they do catch the thieves. How long will they be thrown in jail?
Well, complicated question. We do know who the thieves are. We announced that in 2013. We know who the thieves are. They can't lead us to the paintings. That's the problem. But the statute of limitations ran out in 1995. It was a 5-year statute of limitations, so nobody can be arrested for stealing the paintings. The only crime, well, there are a few crimes associated with this. One would be whoever's holding them right now is committing a crime in terms of possession of stolen property, and that's an ongoing crime. But the United States Attorney has announced clearly and publicly and often that they're willing to entertain immunity. So if you're the thief holding these things, you have immunity, we promise anonymity, and $5 million. I don't know what they're waiting for. Yes, Carl.
Last month there was a story about some con man, gangster, mobster in Connecticut that was either trying to sell two of the paintings and he was arrested, I think, on some unrelated charges. Mm-hmm. Can you tell us about that and how it relates, if it does at all, to the heist?
It does relate. I can tell you in limited terms because it's an ongoing prosecution. But I can tell you that guy's name is Robert Gentile. We've mentioned him before publicly as someone we believe a person of interest in the theft. He was arrested last month for selling a gun to a convicted murderer while he was on probation. And he... he was arrested on charges unrelated to the Gardner. It's important to remember that. But in court, his lawyer said that he was arrested merely because it was a setup because we think he was involved in the Gardner, and that's ridiculous. He had nothing to do with the Gardner. So the federal prosecutor mentioned that he is on tape a number of times trying to sell the Gardner paintings. So those are facts. But it's an ongoing affair right now, so I don't want to say things I probably shouldn't say. Especially with television going. Yes, sir.
Among major art heists, how many of them are inside jobs?
That's a great question. How many major art heists are inside jobs? The FBI estimates that 85 to 90% involve inside information. So that could be unwittingly giving information to somebody. Doesn't necessarily mean complicity, but there's a high probability there's an insider involved, and that's probably the first place you look when a major art theft type happens. Some sort of inside information. Yes, sir?
How well has the science of security developed to make these kinds of thefts, you know, very, very difficult, mm-hmm. or more difficult. How much more difficult is it now than it would have been 25 years ago?
Technology has advanced greatly, so it's much more difficult, but there's no such thing as 100% security, right? And if you check Google News or you look in your newspaper and you pay close attention, you'll see art theft happens every week. There's some painting or something being stolen. It's an enormously active crime. I think what you have to do is spend more time, not just with the technology, but you have to use philosophical approaches and make sure you're building layers of security so that you don't have one or two or three failures leading to a catastrophe. It has to be a real sensible approach to, like, for instance, this is no big secret. If you come to those of you who have been to the Gardner before we built the addition and now realize that you now have to walk very far before you see paintings. In the old days, remember the entrance right off of the Fenway? You were about 10 yards from the Yellow Room. We have Madame Gaujolin by Degas and Dewing and the first Cezanne in America, and I never slept when that was the case. But so you build these layers around it. So we have all of the latest and greatest at the Gardner. Should mention, there's always been this absolute fabrication that everyone knew security was lax at the Gardner. It's complete baloney. It's the type of thing people say after a theft. Right? Think about what I just showed you. We were the last museum to have our Rembrandt stolen, right? It's something people say afterwards. Security at the Gardner at the time of the heist was just as good as anywhere else. It's just an old wives' tale. That seems like it's it. Thank you so much, folks.